Today we're going to look at the type of thing that really confuses people on the internet and how to not get confused by it. This is a tweet that got really popular. I no longer accept the paradigm that high LDL cholesterol is the cause of heart disease. It was posted by a cardiothoracic surgeon, which is part of the reason it blew up. Now, I'm blurring out the author, which is a little unusual, but we're trying this out, even though you could totally find it if you really wanted to. You could search for it. But the idea is this way we can focus on the substance, okay, the content of the claims. People get distracted online with who said what and personal attacks and that guy's biased, I trust this one. This way we shove all of that aside and we focus only on the substance. So he doesn't believe that high LDL cholesterol causes heart disease. Why not? He says half the patients I do surgery on have normal or low cholesterol. So he goes on to say cholesterol doesn't matter. Heart disease is all about glucose metabolism. This is a very common idea online. So there are several misunderstandings packed into these two tweets, which is why we wanted to feature this. First, the paradigm that high LDL cholesterol causes heart disease. Is that really the current paradigm? Is this accurate? Not at all. We've known for years that it's not high cholesterol that causes heart disease. It's the vehicles that carry cholesterol in our blood, the so-called lipoproteins. Think of it this way. More cars on the road causes a traffic jam. It doesn't matter if the cars are packed or if it's just a driver in there. Same with lipids. It's the number of vehicles that determines plaque and artery blockage. It doesn't matter if those lipoproteins have more or less cholesterol in them. Now, most of the time, those two parameters correlate pretty well. If cholesterol is high, there's usually more lipoproteins as well. But in about 20 to 30% of us, the two do not match. And when that happens, the risk of heart disease follows the number of lipoproteins, the number of vehicles, not the cholesterol level. We can count the number of these lipoproteins that cause heart disease present in our blood with a test called apoB. So people with high apoB and low cholesterol have high risk, and vice versa. If your apoB is low, even if your cholesterol is high, you have low risk. So it's apoB that causes heart disease. High cholesterol is a decent indicator in most people most of the time. It's a red flag, but it's not the cause. This is widely accepted in lipid science, and we've known it for years. For example, this was written 4 years ago. ApoB is a better marker of cardiovascular risk than LDL cholesterol. They even say we should reframe the lipid hypothesis as the lipoprotein particle hypothesis. And here's the same idea spelled out 40 years ago. The lipid hypothesis could be re-examined as a lipoprotein hypothesis. The risk is most proportional to the number of particles, not the level of LDL cholesterol. And this article was just published, and they called it "The Debate is Over," because at this point there's so much evidence for the vehicles and against cholesterol itself as cause that the experts don't think that there's even a debate anymore. So this tweet is essentially a misunderstanding of the evidence base. Because high LDL cholesterol is often used as an indicator of risk, he seems to think that scientists are under the impression that it causes heart disease. But that's not what the evidence shows, and it's not what experts in this field say either. And the irony is, this is meant as a bit of an anti-establishment statement, sort of a experts are wrong, which is always a very popular tone on the internet. But the irony is, this ends up being perfectly aligned with expert opinion. And not even new opinion, but something that goes back decades. It's totally old news. More importantly, let's look at the underlying logic of how he got to this conclusion, because we can learn a lot there. His reasoning was most of his patients have normal or low LDL cholesterol, so high LDL cholesterol can't be the cause of heart disease. Now, that actually sounds compelling at first glance, but scientifically, it isn't. For example, are these patients on cholesterol-lowering drugs? Statins lower cardiovascular risk, but they don't eliminate it completely. There's still what's called residual risk left. Why would that be? Well, because lowering your cholesterol slows down the buildup of plaque into the future. And statins also have a plaque stabilization effect that helps lower risk. But there's still plaque burden. Statins don't magically remove all the plaque that's been accumulated previously. So it's entirely normal, it's even common, for someone to be on a statin and have low cholesterol and yet still have some risk of a heart attack. The risk is lower than if the cholesterol was higher, but it's not zero. There's still some risk left, some residual risk, second factor that can be misleading and needs to be taken into account. Cholesterol levels actually drop right after a heart attack. This is so well established, it even has its own acronym, APR, acute phase response. This study explains it. Acute coronary syndrome, that's basically a heart attack, affects the concentration of lipids and lipoproteins in plasma, in blood. Among other changes, low-density lipoprotein, that's LDL, and total cholesterol decrease. This can also happen during inflammation, infection, trauma. It's basically a physiological reaction to shock. So if I'm seeing heart attack patients and measuring their cholesterol right there and then, it's going to be lower in that time window. And if I'm not aware of APR, I might conclude, well, these people all have low cholesterol. I guess cholesterol level has no relation to heart attacks, which would be a complete misunderstanding. This is like a police officer saying, I get called to car crash sites all the time. And every single time I get there, the cars are stopped, like 100% motionless. So don't give me this mumbo jumbo about speed being a risk factor for accidents. I don't buy it. I've been to 1,000 car crash sites. I've seen 1,000 accidents. And every time I get there, I see zero speed. The conditions after the accident don't necessarily reflect the conditions that led up to the accident. It's exactly the same with heart disease. Lipid levels in the acute phase of a heart attack don't necessarily reflect the lipid levels in the years and decades that led up to the heart attack. So far we have cholesterol-lowering drugs and this change in lipid levels in the acute phase of disease. Both factors that could muddy the waters and confuse interpretation. Third confounding factor, and the last one we're going to talk about today. The threshold where we say cholesterol is high is not where risk starts. For example, studies have shown that the higher your cholesterol, the more plaque you tend to have. General trend. There are some exceptions, and it's not a perfect straight line, but there's a clear dose-dependent effect. More plaque, the higher your LDL cholesterol. So in the US, LDL cholesterol is said to be normal under 100 milligrams per deciliter. But as you can see, people under 100 can still have plaque. Less than at 150, an average, but not zero. It only gets to around the zero range when you get under 60 or 70. So patients with normal cholesterol can still have plaque, and yet high cholesterol is a clear risk factor. There's no contradiction. The problem is this arbitrary threshold of 100. It's confusing, even for doctors sometimes, because it suggests that under 100, I should definitely be fine. When in reality, it's more like a continuous slope. It's not a sharp transition right at that point of 100. This can get even a little bit more confusing because intermediate levels of cholesterol, of LDL cholesterol, around 80, 90, 100, 110, 120, that range are much more common in the population than extreme levels like, say, 200. There's even a meme that people often share on the internet. You might have seen this. I've seen even doctors share this. It's basically data for people hospitalized for heart disease and their LDL cholesterol levels at admission. And the most common level measured was around 90 milligrams per deciliter and 100 after that. Now, a lot of people look at this and go, aha, so having a cholesterol of 200 over here is actually protective because not that many people with 200 are being admitted with heart disease. But that's a massive misunderstanding. First of all, it ignores the acute drop of APR, of acute phase response we talked about. Levels at admission in the acute phase of a heart attack don't necessarily reflect the levels leading up to the event. But also, there's just more people with cholesterol around 100 than around 200. It's just more common. So this distribution is in part an artifact of base rate, of the prevalence in the population. In fact, this meme is taken from this study, where the authors concluded the findings may provide support for guideline revisions with even lower LDL goals. So they're saying their findings suggest we should be trying to get LDL cholesterol lowered even further. So people are looking at this figure in isolation and concluding high cholesterol is fine or even protective. When the study it's taken from and the scientists who made the figure are saying the exact opposite. Welcome to the internet. Now, let's not get distracted. The point here is not to give people sharing this on the internet a hard time. The confusion is completely understandable. This isn't the simplest topic in the world, and People are sitting online being exposed to these isolated shreds of evidence, completely out of context. They don't have training in this field. Of course they're going to be puzzled. I've seen even doctors be confused by this. So we just have to be very careful with snap judgments. Now, hopefully this is all kind of clear so far, but if not, imagine this. Say I'm a lung doctor, and over the course of a year, I see 100 patients with lung cancer. There will be more people that smoked one or two packs a day than people who smoked 10 packs a day. Not because 10 packs is protective, but because it's just much less common in the population. The solution, of course, is to look at risk. What percentage of people who smoke one pack a day go on to get lung cancer, and what percentage of people who smoke 10 packs a day go on to get lung cancer? And we'll find that for 10 packs, it's higher. The risk is higher, even though it's less common in the population. Same for cholesterol. Risk is generally higher for higher LDL cholesterol levels. Even if very high cholesterol is not that common in hospital admissions or at the point where people need surgery to fix their hearts. That's what this study and many others have shown. One last example to drive this home. Say I'm only seeing patients who bump their heads. I'm going to see a lot of people who are 6'1", 6'2", but not a lot of people who are 7 feet tall. And that's not because being 7 feet tall is protective for bumping your head. It's just less common in the population. The base rate is low. So I have to look at risk. What percentage of 7-footers bump their heads? Not just say, well, I don't usually see them in my practice, so I guess height has nothing to do with bumping your head. That's the logical flaw behind his reasoning. I think that's enough analogies for today, right? The whole point here is that we have to be very cautious with these glib statements on social media, these one-liners that just seem to make sense at first glance. People love stuff like this. It's short, it seems to make common sense, it's against the grain, especially if it's written by someone with credentials who should know. It's viral material. This type of content spreads massive confusion. Now, don't get discouraged. Maybe this seems a little complicated, all these different factors at play. How can we ever know anything for sure? Should we just give up and live randomly and ignore all science? No, it's actually not that complicated if we rely on the most robust evidence. What we want to do is measure cholesterol levels before the disease is present, and then follow people for years and see the disease develop and relate that to the cholesterol levels preceding the appearance of the disease. That's called a prospective design. Or even better, split people randomly and lower cholesterol of just one group, the other stays high, and then look at what percentage of each group gets heart disease. This is like the cop catching the cars miles before the accidents and picking them up with a radar, right, and measuring their speed, and then relating speed to the likelihood of having an accident down the road. You see how this is way more conclusive? People are like, this guy makes one more analogy, I'm going back to cat videos. So these prospective designs, these randomized control trials, these have been done dozens of times. One group gets a placebo, the other gets a cholesterol-lowering drug, and they don't even know who's getting what. It's double-blinded. And the group that gets the cholesterol-lowering drug, sure enough, has their cholesterol lowered and goes on to have lower cardiovascular risk. Also, people born with low cholesterol, determined genetically, have lower cardiovascular risk and even lower risk of death. That's how we know conclusively that LDL cholesterol is a pretty good indicator of risk, a red flag for most people. And I say indicator because those same drugs that lower LDL cholesterol also lower apoB. And as we saw, when the two parameters mismatch, risk follows apoB, not cholesterol. So apoB is the cause. Bottom line, we don't ignore high LDL cholesterol. It's a red flag. In most people, most of the time, it indicates high apoB. But it's not the direct cause. So when in doubt, measure apoB and get that in the healthy range. We actually made a whole video on dietary tweaks to lower apoB. I hope that all makes sense. I know there's a lot of nuance, but I hope the basic idea is clear. We have to be skeptical of oversimplistic claims. People get tripped up by this all the time, including doctors. So be cautious, dig deeper, ask to see the evidence, fact check everybody, including me, of course. It's a lot more work, but it's totally worth it in the end. All right, let me know your thoughts below. Take care. I'll see you next time.